Top mic. Good evening, everyone. My name is John Komatsi. I'm an associate professor of architecture here in the College of Design, and I am honored to be introducing tonight's lecturer. I can think of perhaps no better lecturer to personify, literally personify, the lecture series theme of global practices. If James Brown is the hardest working man in show business, tonight's lecturer quite possibly may very well be the James Brown of architecture. Which is perhaps the primary reason it's taken us so long to finally get him to lecture here. We're honored to have him here tonight. But of course, Rahul Mehrotra is not simply hardworking. For his exemplary scholarship and practice in architecture, design education, urban planning and design, conservation advocacy and policy, and numerous contemporary surveys, have positioned Professor Mehrotra and his collaborators at the forefront of debate about the role of design amidst the unprecedented transformations affecting dynamic places like Professor Mehrotra's home city of Mumbai, India. Rahul is currently a professor of urban design and planning and chair of the Department of Urban Planning and Design in the Graduate School of Design at Harvard University. In addition to his teaching, leadership, and scholarship as an educator of architecture and urban design, he also embodies the title Global Practitioner as he manages to maintain a successful practice on the other side of the globe in Mumbai. His firm, RMA Architects, was founded in 1990. And has designed and executed projects for clients that include government and non-governmental agencies, corporate as well as private individuals and institutions. RMA Architects has also initiated several unsolicited projects driven by the firm's commitment to advocacy in the city of Mumbai. The firm recently finished a campus for Magic Bus, an NGO that works with poor children. The restoration, and I hope we see this, the restoration of the Chowmahalla Palace in Hyderabab, and with the Taj Mahal Conservation Collaborative, a conservation master plan for the Taj Mahal. This is the one I really hope we see. The firm is currently working on a social housing project for 100 elephants and their caretakers in Jaipur, as well as corporate offices in Hyderabad and several single-family houses throughout India. In fact, I hear that that's now 45 single-family houses in India. So in addition to his teaching and his practice, Mehrotra has written and lectured extensively on issues to do with architecture, conservation, and urban planning in Mumbai and India more broadly. His writings include co-authoring Bombay, The Cities Within, which covers the city's urban history from the 1600s to the present, Public Places, Bombay, Anchoring a City Line, a History of the City's Commuter Railway, and Bombay to Mumbai, Changing Perspectives. His other publications include books on Victoria Terminus Station, a World Heritage Site in Mumbai, and most recently, this thoughtful and beautiful illustrated book on architecture in India since 1990. So in addition to his teaching, practice, and scholarship, he's long been actively involved in civic and urban affairs in Mumbai, having served on commissions for historic preservation and environmental issues with various neighborhood groups, and from 1994 to 2004 as executive director of the Urban Design Research Institute. He studied at the School of Architecture at CEPT, right, and graduated with a master's degree with distinction in urban design from the GSD. From 2003 to 2007, he taught at the University of Michigan's Taubman College of Architecture and Urban Planning, where I was lucky enough to have been a colleague of Rahul's. And at the School of Architecture and Urban Planning at MIT from 2007 to 2010. And if that were all not enough, Rahul, along with his wife and partner, Nandita Correa Mehrotra, herself an accomplished architect and educator, always found the time, energy, and effort to model what it means to be supportive colleagues, strong mentors, and generous friends, especially to those of us who were just starting our careers as educators and practitioners. And for this, I'm personally thankful. So please help me give a warm Minnesota welcome to Professor Rahul Mehrotra.
John, apologies, I'm not going to show you the Taj Mahal. I'm sorry about this. You should have told me, I would have included it. But no, thank you very much for this opportunity. It's really a delight to be here. And you know, I know John and others have taken this sort of real effort to try to coordinate dates and things. It's taken us a whole year, but I'm so happy I'm here, so thanks again. So, you know, trying to come up with a title for a lecture is always very hard. We tend to sort of look for themes, and we tend to, you know, look at things that might hold the work together. And I think the best way I could explain my work is situated in the place that I sort of work in. And so I've called it Working in Mumbai. And I almost, you know, at 4:30 over a cup of tea, I almost sort of convinced these guys that I should come back for your local practitioner series, because I'm not a global practitioner. I've done nothing outside India. It's all very local work. I only teach in the US and think about questions globally, which might be what qualified me for this, but the practice is all local, so apologies in advance if I disappoint any of you and don't show you museums and other things in sexy places around the world. So, working in Mumbai, it's really about negotiating a landscape, I believe, where global flows don't erase and remake the landscape, but actually occupy local fissures in this landscape. And they kind of, in the process, create a really fascinating hybrid condition. And as a result, in physical terms, really startling adjacencies. I mean, that's what sort of characterizes this landscape that I draw nourishment from in my own work. And I think more importantly, it is that intangible readings of places that we work in, that we are really rooted in and situated in, that bear substantially, I think, in the way we perceive architecture, cities, design in general. And I think this is what has influenced the way we have approached our building and our practice and our approach to building and practice, which is what I'm going to share with you over this next 50 minutes or an hour. And the way I've structured this lecture is I'm going to share with you six issues or questions or conditions or things that we've been engaged with thinking about, and then share with you six or seven projects independently. But in the process of sharing my sort of read on these issues, I'll sort of also throw some projects in which begin to illustrate this. So it's a bit scrambled, but I hope it's coherent. So, it's, you know, these are the questions that sort of, I think, in reflection, which is a real luxury, and I think what I enjoy most about being in the U.S. and teaching here is the ability to reflect from a distance. And it's these sort of questions that I've been thinking about, or I've been able to see more clearly in retrospect, that have influenced our work. Often when you're on the ground, you're acting. You're acting because of urgencies to respond to things. You're acting because you feel compelled morally to engage with something. You're reacting because you're emotively excited about something. And it's with retrospective kind of views that you can begin to classify them, so to speak. So research advocacy is the first one I'll look at, because research and advocacy for me were very, very important to our practice right from the start. And John was mentioning some of the books, and we sort of produced quite a lot of books in the 15 or 20 years that I've been in practice. But it was accidental often. It was research that was an integral part of practice. It was part triggered off by an exercise to support advocacy sometimes. But it also led to many things. But essentially, it was really a response to the lack of archival material, writing, and thinking about the city, which was when I started working there in 1990. I couldn't believe it, that the city that was going through transformations that my generation, I think, in the history of human beings hasn't seen, had no documented evidence or archival material in any organized way about the built environment. And this was startling. And so one began to get involved for that reason. And then slowly, we began to you know, lobbied to save a building and produced a book around it. We started getting involved with legislation. Documents came out of it that were followed seminars. And so this became a kind of production. We even set up a publishing company. A friend of mine, Sharda Devedi, set it up, and we co-authored a number of books because we don't find takers. And so these are not, I won't, a lot of this, some of this, these do, but most of them don't qualify as scholarship, but they are really intuitive arguments about the city, about the need to engage with the physical form of the city. And the fallout of this was interesting. Some of it led to our practice actually veering into preservation. So I wasn't trained in historic preservation, but it's a result of engaging with these things that I realized as an architect who was equipped to imagine spatial conditions and intervene in building fabric, material fabric, that one felt confident to do this. But it was the rigor of going through the research exercise that equipped one to do that, which otherwise would have been very, very difficult. And of course, it led us to measured drawing, which is something that I, you know, had lost contact with, in at least the way I was educated, and going back to measure buildings to get a sense of scale, to kind of feel these places, to do measure drawings. And these are from the Hyderabab Palace that John referred to. We produced about 120 drawings. This is a pretty incredible portfolio, all measured because there was no sort of data. And then engaged with the restoration of this complex. It's over 12 acres. We worked on it for 10 years. These are slow processes. And that entire ceiling you see in that hall was completely rebuilt because craftsmanship exists. And the building has now been converted into a museum. We engaged with materials. This was all restored in lime plaster, which is a really interesting, fascinating, slow process. But it engages you again with the quality of building in completely different ways outside your training and your space of comfort. And now we've sort of converted it into a museum with a very low budget, so it has no elaborate air conditioning. But it's just sort of meant for people in the city, in the inner city, to enjoy these spaces, but also learn about the Nizam's family, who kind of built this complex and many other parts of Hyderabad. The documentation and writing also led us to actually formulate the first urban conservation legislation in India, which was instituted in Mumbai. And in 95, this was instituted. We did a series of workshops. And again, this came because of my urban design training. I didn't have a historic preservation training, but as an urban designer, I could see the clarity by which the historic district was sort of delineated on the ground, and made an argument for policy that would help us sort of move to preserve it. And that led to advocacy, and so we began to then actually, as advocate planners, formulate districts, set up citizens groups, and engage with the conservation of these places. So this is one such district. You can see that parking lot. We sort of raised money through instituting a festival to put street furniture, signage, paving, which, you know, is very low in the priority of the state government or the city government in a place like Mumbai, because they're dealing with housing and sanitation. So this stuff doesn't sort of even come under their radar. And so how we could step into that space to do that. And now, of course, this has been instituted. And this area, this is the art district. There's also an anchor institution, which is the Prince of Wales Museum. And in the process of the research of creating an art district for the city and creating what I was calling an art infrastructure for the city, we discovered this was an amazing resource which had a warehouse that had been sort of lying empty, and it had an existing building which could serve as a visitor center. And we actually initiated these two projects and proposed to the museum how they could completely expand their facilities and contribute to the art infrastructure by opening up these spaces. And so they sort of also resulted in projects. So, I mean, I think the point I'm making is that the research and advocacy, if you see it as a pure activity, it's one thing. It becomes scholarly, and of course it's, I think, valid. But if you also see it as being embedded in the practice, then it becomes inherent to the practice and leads to many other things, some of which you do pro bono, some of which you are paid for as projects. And this sort of internal cross-subsidy, I believe, is what makes practice very interesting. And I think in a landscape like India, which is highly pluralistic in terms of the spectrum of issues that you have to deal with, this kind of inbuilt cross-subsidy becomes a model of practice, which is what I'm going to share with you. And so in this building, this was a warehouse. These were blank facades. We intervened by adding a veranda space here, which could create circulation, and it opened up, and fire exits, etc. So it opened up 50,000 square feet for the building. So that's the plan. That's a measured drawing, again, because drawings didn't exist. And so we intervened by just adding this in steel. And we created stone piers removing the stone from that existing wall. So it was authentic in terms of the material just being transferred. And it was freestanding, so it's reversible. So another generation doesn't agree to this approach to a grade one building, they can actually reverse it. And so that's what it sort of looks like. Those are the piers in stone. This is the veranda, which makes the connections. It's all in steel. It's contemporary, but it's separate from the existing building. And an old light shaft was converted into a circulation spine. And then we began to see there was an existing building here, which was in concrete, built in the 60s. And by wrapping a very light canopy around it, we created a visitor center. So these were two contemporary interventions in a historic district. But through these two interventions, this large anchor facility in this historic district became activated and became integral to the art infrastructure. So not only did it contribute to expanding the art infrastructure for that district, but the museum itself has much more visitors now because of these facilities. So I'm just going to show you very briefly this little project, which is a visitor center. That's the baggage thing. So it's sort of very abstract when you come in there. It doesn't tell you, you know, what is where till you go around and discover it. And that's the historic building. And this was the existing building, so it's a very light canopy that we wrapped around it, integrating some of the existing trees. It's sort of, that's where you pick up your bags on the way out, you drop them around the corner there, and you go through security and stuff to enter the building. And of course, we fabricated every sort of element. We sort of did this in steel, but also as a contemporary counterpoint to the historic building. And through the reflections, it sort of kind of dissolves aesthetically, visually. It's very low scale, so it works. So it was interesting that here we began with a historic preservation agenda, then an agenda to integrate this as art infrastructure, but then also landed up doing a very small but contemporary building. And then, of course, the questions of how do you intervene in a historic district with a contemporary sensibility. But this sort of research also gets us to look at the city in broader terms. And for me, that is very important. One has learned a great deal from it. And I find that one of the things that I've really learned looking at Mumbai, which is sort of useful for larger debates about informal cities and all of that, is I've become very averse to the binaries that are set up in the rhetoric that we use in urban planning, urban design, and architecture. So I hate using the word informal city, for example, because I think when you say formal and informal, rich and poor, permanent and temporary, you set up binaries which are very unuseful, because then you have to, as a designer, you make an alliance with one end of that binary. So you either become this guy who's working in formal cities, or you become this guy who's working with developers in the formal city. It's very hard to combine those two. The same thing for, I mean, a whole lot of binaries that sort of entered our rhetoric. So I call Mumbai a kinetic city, and I think a kinetic city is a particular kind of urbanism, a condition of urbanism, which is very particular to Mumbai and many other cities. And of course, this is a lecture in itself. But I mean, I think here it is a city where the city itself is a kind of elastic condition. It's not about grand vision, but it's about grand adjustment. And so the temporal landscape becomes a very important part of this. And so this amazing image of this wonderful festival that happens in India, and today was actually the first day of this festival. It runs for 10 days, and yesterday was the first day of the Ganpati festival in India and in Mumbai, where for 10 days they have this incredible celebration, and then about 5 million people participate in this festival. So here, this is the spectacle of the city. Architecture is not the spectacle of the city. And this great idol statue is immersed on the last day. And as this idol, which is made out of clay, dissolves in the water, the memory of the city disappears. So the memory of the city itself is an enacted moment. And this is what I mean by the kinetic city, where associative values and use patterns determine the form of the city more than architecture as an instrument that begins to define what the city might be. And so during the festival, entire streets get colonized. So here this you see traffic, but at night the traffic will close and this becomes this great auditorium where dance performances, Bollywood films, etc. are shown in the open air. And so suddenly there's this appropriation of space, which is very, very interesting. And so this elastic condition, I think, is very important. Leading from that is this question of softening thresholds. For me, that is really a big, big question, and I'll try to show you how one can even respond to this in architecture. So when you have such adjacencies, which is very different, say, from Latin America, I think in Latin America, the favelas are quite different in terms of even what they do, because in Mumbai, for example, the slums are centers of production. They are integral to the city, and they also are physically in adjacencies or in patterns which are completely integral to the city. And so in this condition for the designer, one of the biggest challenges is how do you soften thresholds between these adjacencies? How do you dissolve these binaries that I was talking about to be able to find spaces to intervene? Because these are very extreme conditions, the world's biggest house and perhaps the world's smallest form of dwelling, just a little cloth that's put on a sidewalk. You know, so when you have such extremities, how does one even respond? And this is all part of this sort of changing city. And so, for example, the public spaces, this is cricket on the maidans. These are open spaces in Mumbai, and this is a wonderful sport. It's a, I mean, in India, we say this is an Indian sport invented by the British, but it's sort of something that everyone enjoys, and it's like religion. But what happens in the evenings during wedding seasons is it gets taken over by a wedding. And it's interesting how that is all set up. It starts at about 3 in the afternoon. By the evening, the wedding is set up. This is a kitchen which serves the wedding, but it also serves the club members who are taking high tea. The cricket pitch is sacred, so no one touches it. And this is a sort of symbiotic kind of thing where the city's margins have been made elastic to accommodate unimaginable uses in the same space. So this idea of purely single designations gets completely blurred. And by the morning, it returns to a cricket field. It leaves no memory. It leaves no trace. It touches the ground very lightly in bamboo and cloth. And I think these are the interesting phenomena that make this kinetic urbanism that I'm talking about, which is a very particular cultural condition, etc. And so I think describing it in these terms, I think, gives us space as designers to see where we can imagine we can intervene. Otherwise, when you set up the binaries, I think the alliances narrow what you can do. Now, in high-density conditions, this resolution becomes much easier. But when you go to the sort of peripheries of Mumbai, and this is the case of farmhouses, which is an amazing phenomena on the peripheries of a density like Mumbai, everyone's building these smart houses for very rich people. And so, like, this is a typical house that sort of is built there. It is a freestanding Palladian kind of villa paradigm where the symmetry of the house and its image is on the exterior, unlike the traditional Indian house where the interior, the courtyard, is where symmetry is established. But this is a house built for a rich person, not even with an architect involved. It's a contractor who designed and built it. I remember meeting him on the boat there, and I said, who's the architect of this house that you're designing? And he says, oh, no, I'm designing it myself. She just gave me a picture of the White House and said, get us close. And so that's what he sort of did. And so you then begin to start having these interventions which create immense polarization in those environments, because these are rural landscape with small little villages with often very poor people, and you have these urban interventions that set up this sort of polarization. And so in addressing it, we were asked to design a house which for a young filmmaker, and what we did was we decided to create a living room. This is the living room of the house, which is an offering to the village. So on the weekdays when these barn doors are closed, the furniture is moved in, and the couple who owns the house leave, this is appropriated by the caretaker, his family, the villagers alongside. I've even seen a wedding happen there once when I visited. So it becomes a generous offering to the village. It has a tap there because these roofs collect water on this sort of channel, recharge the well. So the amenity of the water and this one space becomes an offering to the city. So this is what I mean by softening these thresholds, or at least having the ambitions to do that programmatically. Of course, now many other houses have been built here. It's got more hemmed in, so of course the uses will change. But in its original conception, that's what it did. It's got this sort of circulation space which forms the channel. The roofs all drain into it. The bedrooms face a more suburban landscape, which is also an aspiration of the owners. But the living rooms faces a landscape which is left very raw for people to sort of meander through. These are the taps that they can use for water, and all that light furniture is just sort of pulled in when they go away. And so similarly, we did a house outside Ahmedabad, which again, it was in an orchard. It was a large orchard. Instead of placing the house at the head of the orchard, which is the colonial paradigm, we placed it in the center, and it sort of sits right in the middle of the orchard, and you enter it, and it's sort of an oasis-like sort of feeling. It's this fresh water without chlorination, which the owners use when they come there once in 2 months. They use it for swimming, but when they leave, the farm workers can actually use it to wash fruit, and then it's recharged back into the well. But also, the courtyard, which becomes part of this pool, is appropriated by the owners when they're there. But when the owners are not there and the door closes, there's a separate entrance into which the workers can sort of enter and appropriate the court. So then the court has sort of got this dual coding that it actually works for both people at both times. And again, these become ways that perhaps one can move towards doing that. And similarly, this last a couple of more houses I'll show you where this is a house in a tea plantation where the owner bought the tea but wanted to cut it down and build lawns and a little mini putting range and all of that. But we convinced them that leave the tea, touch the house lightly at one end. He said, well, I want a log cabin in the middle of the house. So we gave him these three rooms clad in wood under the stainless steel roof. So we had the log cabin. We were honest to his brief. But we kind of created another imagery which actually subverted the imagery of a villa in a tea plantation. And for me, the great success of this house was that locally they all call it the tea factory. So for the villagers who live around here, they don't even associate it as a house for a rich person. And they call it the tea factory because it does yet produce tea. It was sort of set up using sort of mock-ups in bamboo so that we could touch it very lightly with the veranda, and you see the three log cabins. There are nice moments in it when you enter through a porch. You have light in this form-finished concrete thing, a light glass tube that connects it, and the big roof with these three rooms. And it's a very simple diagram along this spine, which is built in the local granite. And so those are views from the veranda. They frame the views. And then this is the passage, which is in granite, which has light apertures, and sort of it uses a paduk wood, which is a sort of localish red wood, which is sort of interesting and very labor intensive. And it's yet used, the tea is picked, it's used, it's processed in nearby factories. And so this last house, again, where, again, situated in a village, how does one sort of make offerings for the village? So we created a plinth, which is sort of halfway up to the house, which is right adjacent to the kitchen, so the owners could invite villagers when they come in for business or people who are tending their farm. They can sit here and tea can be served to them from the kitchen, so they feel they have actually penetrated and entered the house, but they have yet not actually come into the innards of the house where, you know, the owners would want more privacy. But instead of sort of isolating them completely, the house begins to embrace and make more porous or more transparent the sort of transgression into the house. And then within the house, there's a lap pool and, you know, all the usual sort of kit of parts that they need for weekend houses, but articulated again using materials of the locale, but trying to keep it as non-ostentatious as possible. So then that leads to the bigger question of a building ecology and what that means, because this is all part of a more complex society, and the social has to necessarily, as you saw, even in softening these thresholds or otherwise, the social has to necessarily be material when we are considering architecture, because it's in a place like Mumbai, the centrifugal force of urbanism has sort of created unprecedented densities, and so anyone sort of who's dealing with these spatial arrangements has to sort of deal with the social as sort of material for building. And so when we talk about sustainable design questions and things, it becomes sort of highly problematic if you don't do that, which is what's, I think, unfortunately happened in the West, where it's become highly building-centric, because I think you really need a combination of social ecology, economy, and physical design. And this image here is a little hawker stand in Mumbai, and what's wonderful are these sort of things, these sachets that hang, which creates a beautiful visual culture because they create partitions for their shops with this. But this is really what Procter Gamble sort of made a massive breakthrough in the developing world and in the South. Pralad, C.K. Pralad, professor at the University of Michigan, who died 2 years ago, wrote this beautiful, I mean, very sort of well-argued book, which was about, called The Bottom of the Pyramid, where he showed how the bottom of the pyramid, the poor, were the biggest markets. It's a matter of how you brand and market. And so, for example, a bottle of shampoo, which would normally cost a laborer a whole month's salary, if you broke down into little sachets which they could use for one bath, they don't have to lock their month's salary in it. And so that opens up a massive market. So now they do that for a number of products, this sort of incrementalism. And so these are strategies. I mean, it's an interesting question. I don't know the solution, but those become interesting strategies to be inspired by in our own work when we're intervening in cities. But going back to ecology and to sustainability, I think it's interesting how in all our discussions, especially in the global north and the west, the discussion has all moved from weathering to weatherproofing. So we are now obsessed with how we weatherproof things. So our obsession is with sealants and how transparent the sealants are and how we have double glass and triple glass, and then the LEED sort of rating pushes you even into a more deadly corner, because what they have unwittingly perhaps done is create a hegemony of US codes, which have now been exported globally. They don't necessarily lead to more ecological solutions, but what they do is they give you a whole range of chemical and mechanical fixes to any problem. And so we create remarkable problems which are premised often on visual, privileging visual sort of decisions. And then we've got a palette of things to choose from in a incredibly fast expanding green economy and industry to provide a mechanical and chemical fix to almost any problem, whether it's making your fans more efficient, et cetera. And I think this is going to be problematic. And I think it is eventually the question of lifestyle and going back to place and locale and weather, climate, that will determine the success of our ability to respond spatially, I believe, in achieving sustainable design paradigms. And I think for all of us practitioners around the world, that's going to be a big, big challenge. And so the question of climate, for example, in Mumbai, we have a pretty flat climate. The only time that we sense a change in the climate is when the monsoon arrives. And it's intimidating, as you can see in this image, but it's also, it celebrates life because the landscape bursts into sort of incredible green, shades of green that you can't imagine. And so how does one respond to that? And this is a house we designed where we sort of designed it for the monsoon, including exploring all the various elements that would bring water down and how sort of you would train the water, where it would land. But it was just a lot of fun to suddenly use climate as just privilege that completely over anything else, and it sort of led you to completely different solutions. And then the question, through historic preservation, how does one fold all these experiences into each other? And the question of the life cycle of materials has been very central to our practice of imagining how, in this case of this house we've done, where the base is in the local stone, it grows out of the ground and it'll last for 50 or 100 years, but then you have lighter elements, in this case the roof, which you might change, you might modulate, you might even change the form of the roof, and this will be a house that could evolve. And so this idea of the life cycle of materials, we often don't imagine buildings through those lenses when we're designing them, because we retrofit those sort of solutions after we've determined, after privileging visually what the configuration of the building would be. But if you use life cycle of materials or climate as a starting point, you'll approach the whole building process quite differently and create a kind of different sensibility. And then that, of course, leads to the question of crafting tradition, which in India, of course, becomes really important because it's all very labor-intensive, handmade, and very easy to do that. And I just threw in these images of our studio, which is a small studio with 14 people. We make a lot of models. And that's just an archival image I pulled out when I started my office with the drafting boards and things. And this is a recent image where all of that has disappeared and their computers. But it's a very small office. It's a studio. We build a lot of things in great intricacy. We use models very extensively. We use mock-ups. There's amazing skills that are yet available. It's very labor intensive. So in conservation, we're using different kinds of skills. These are from John from the Taj Mahal project, where we did these inlays, which were all handcrafted. When we give these guys drawings, they sort of move the drawings aside and they sort of got a photograph, and using these basic tools, sourcing marble from the original quarries, they actually reconstructed these panels quite easily without us intervening. I mean, we shouldn't even be taking credit for it. We can take credit for structuring the project, but I think you let people loose within it. And I think we have to be careful when we celebrate this, because I think they deserve as much in this. And so, for example, again in the Taj Mahal, we did all the conservation work using a camel to grind the lime as it was done traditionally, because when you grind lime at that speed, you get a completely different consistency as opposed to using a mechanical mixer where it starts setting much faster. And so just very, very simple tools, or building lime, that column takes about 3 months to do. So they're working on different columns simultaneously, because you have to wait for the lime to set before you can go to the next level of detail. So it gives you a sense also by by being engaged in such disparate kinds of craft, a sense of time, a different sense and scale of time, a sense of the life cycle of materials. So I think one can fold these lessons into contemporary practice. And I think for us as a community, that's the big challenge, because in a funny way, as we create silos, we also create the same binaries that I was cautioning you against, because we then situate ourselves in one of those silos. We safeguard the integrity of that silo, which means our ability to slide sideways becomes very limited. And that, I think, is highly problematic, both in our pedagogy and just the way we are approaching building. There's a whole range of stone masonry, all of that, but also about engaging with new materials. I mean, concrete is as much the vernacular in India as anything else. And so I think how one sort of brings a rigor to using those materials is important. But I think what we are really interested in craft is extending these crafts, because I'm sort of beginning to be a bit frustrated that things that get celebrated out of India are either wood or stone. And those are traditional crafts. They're very difficult to do now. They're very expensive, which is the truth. And so how do we also engage with industrial materials but bring a sense of craftsmanship to it? Because we've, in our mind, isolated this as being something else. It's industrially produced. And I'll show you how we were tempted to do that. And so then looking at the local and global, for me, that is a very, very exciting issue, because I mean, going back to the dictum of think globally and act locally, I think that's more relevant than ever before. And I think that might be the only way that I can squeeze my qualification for this lecture series, because I think one is trying to, in engaging more broadly and talking to disparate kinds of audiences, trying to extract from these lessons things that can resonate more globally. But at least all my work is all local. I mean, the only one project I was saying to John we've done is we're the only, I think I'm the only Indian architect to have built in Pakistan. I've done a house in Pakistan, which is a story in itself. But otherwise, the work is very, very local. But what is happening in the world is that people are actually thinking very locally and acting globally. So, I mean, I think Dubai is an example of, you know, paradigms evolved in Houston and small Midwestern sort of cities, or, you know, places in America and Europe that who have the power, corporations who have the power to act globally. And I call it the architecture of impatient capital. I mean, impatient capital is bullying us as professionals today. It's an architecture determined more by vendors than by architects. And it's an architecture that is making cities around the world, because it has an impatience in terms of how it is realized and how quickly it's realized. And so you then are left with the options of how much you twist a building, or how high you go, or how you clad it. And of course, I'm just sort of taking this to an extreme. Of course, there's a lot of intelligence bought into it. But those are not the only kinds of intelligent buildings. And I think the idea of an intelligent building has been co-opted by the high techs, which has resulted from what impatient capital has done to architecture. And I think this needs to be challenged, because I think buildings that use very simple ideas are as intelligent as buildings that use high technology. But the local and global is an interesting sort of set of questions, which I think gets relevance again. And this is my carpenter's box, which where Castrol and the pantheon of Hindu gods sit together so easily. And that's really India, where the ancient has resurfaced in amazing ways. When we liberalized the economy in 1990, it's amazing how many, which is what I've tried to capture in this book, temples like the Akshardham and other, the number of unmodern temples that have been built in the last 5 years is mind-boggling. And so this, the presence of the ancient is really exerting itself in very, very strong ways. And the phenomena of Vastu, for example, which is like Feng Shui, it determines location of rooms and principles by which you organize space, has resurrected itself. And the projects I'm going to show you, 50% of those projects actually follow these principles, because they come as the client brief. And of course, one can challenge it and question it. But the point is that these sort of ancient sort of sensibilities begin to play themselves very much into practice. And so that's a Vastu practitioner, the guy sitting on the top. He's a trained engineer, but he has no certificates. He has only certificates of photographs of him meeting holy men, because that sort of validates his sort of third eye or his perceptual qualities. And so that sort of makes him credible. But the rituals that go with the buildings, this is a corporate building we've just done, and I'll show it to you, for an infrastructure company. The building was opened with letting cows into the building to sanitize it. And so these are amazing rituals that are completely at odds with some of the contemporary aspirations and sensibilities that young people even are engaging with. And I'd be happy to discuss that there are reasons why this is happening. It's happening because of the mobility of agrarian communities into kind of capitalist societies. Also, I think what's interesting, my colleague Eve Blau talks about this, is that when we have transitions that go, in our case, from socialism to capitalism, or in East Europe, from communism to capitalism, these are not things that you cross a threshold and you're in another world. These are transitions that are in place simultaneously. And it takes many decades for that complete resolution, if at all. Usually it'll be a hybrid condition. And so in these landscapes, which is going to be very interesting in what we call the third world, or the global south, or I refer to as a majority world, you're going to have many ideological and political transitions in place simultaneously, which will have incredible bearings on the built environment. And you have to see it through that lens to understand these disjunctures that you actually grapple with. And I think that's a really fascinating area of study. And the last one I'm going to, before I take you to projects, I'm sorry this is taking longer than I thought, is models of practice. I think, which is what this book that John was mentioning is about, where I've looked at 20 years in India, but broken it by models of practice, of ways that we engage, the ways we offer instructions to the site, the way that we get briefs from client, the way that we communicate our design intentions. And I think that becomes an interesting way to understand this pluralism that I'm referring to. And so if you look at this map, it's just a very brief, very quick sort of history on modern architecture in India. In India, till the 80s, from the 50s, you had this architectural spine of awareness which started at Chandigarh with Corbusier, Delhi, Ahmedabad, Mumbai, petered off in Goa, and you had a little bit happening in Pondicherry, which was a French colony. Now, in the last 20 years, where the action is, the economy is places like Kolkata, Chennai, Hyderabad, Bangalore, etc. But what's really interesting is that in the next 20 years, we're going to have 400 cities or towns in India, which will be about 1 million people. So about 400 million people are going to live in 392 towns that I can, you know, even with the Indians who might be in this room together, we won't be able to come up with more than 20 names. This is the time bomb, the urban time bomb India is sitting on. And that's going to make this a largely 50% an urban kind of population. Now, my argument is that in these places, they don't carry the baggage or the traditions of modernism. And they're completely different things, emerging sensibilities, aspirations. And so you're going to need many different ways of engaging with the built environment if, as a profession, we want to be effective. And that's why the book was inspired by that idea, to look at it through the lenses of these different models of engagement, to inspire students to actually situate their projects in different ways, and I'm happy to talk more about that. And this just shows you where our projects are, which are largely in this new belt, and that's why they've sort of offered us many new opportunities. We've got a few projects in North India, but they're largely in this sort of belt. So with that, I'm going to sort of jump into these projects. The first set of three or four projects are what I call global programs, and then last four are local. And the global programs are programs like corporate offices and software buildings, et cetera, which come from somewhere. And then the challenge is, how do you localize it? How do you kind of resist the business as usual paradigms that they aspire to engage with? Then the local programs are programs that actually emerge from the ground. They're very specific to the place. But they also fall the trap, and the trap in the brief, of becoming caricatures of the place, because people want them to become localized. And so the challenge for the practitioners, how do you globalize the lessons that you might learn from those programs? How can you give those programs, which are very local, an expression which make them resonate globally, also as lessons for the North and the West and, you know, all of that. And so this first project is one of the early projects we did in 95, four or five years into the practice. It was a big project. The country had just started liberalizing. It's in Coimbatore. It's for the country's biggest machine tool company, Lakshmi Machine Works. But they were very low-key. In the south, everyone's very low-key. They didn't let us even publish it. It's only now that I'm beginning to show it. So we went back to doing houses. We thought we'd got our big breakthrough. We got doing a corporate building. And then we went back to houses because no one knew about this building. And anyway, so it sat on the edge of the cantonment and the city. It's very low-rise density. This is the brief. This is the diagram they actually gave us. We want parking there. We want a garden with a fountain in the front. We want a glass-clad building. We're going corporate. We're going global. We have an Australian company that's going to import the glass. We have the licenses ready. just draw this up for us. And we kind of said, what? And so we engaged with them and convinced them, of course, to do that, which would sit better on the site and would breathe internally. Its sort of image was an internal one, much more traditional, and could be a much more interesting, and we felt a more confident expression of a company like that that had a great product and was wanting to engage more globally. And so we came up with a building with a series of courtyards which established a privacy gradient through it. These were apertures that brought light into the building, bounced light. It also made it very transparent, so people, it wasn't a glass block where you just see a reflection, and for poorer people who are not engaged with the corporation, it's a complete excluding from the building in any way. It's not urban. And so here, it's a three courtyards with water which cools the last two courtyards, and this is an entrance courtyard, and from the street that's what you see, but it's sort of there's a sequence that you go through. The roof is held at one level and you sort of walk through the building, and that's the water that sort of rotates there to cool it. It's circulated to cool it, and from the street you sort of see right through the courtyard, so people sort of sit very easily with the building, and as you go through it there's a sort of sequence of spaces. The green sort of gets telescopically visually collapse, so you always sense the green, lotus ponds, groves, and as you go into the upper levels, the circulation space is all external, so it also becomes verandas where meetings can happen, people can meet. There's seven companies that this larger company owns, so there's much more interaction, places for people to meet, and as you go into the higher floors of the building where the management sits, it is down to the scale of a large chetinar or the local area's house, and this sits in the rain shadow, so it's a very dry climate here, and so circulating water, not only the sound of water makes it very beautiful, but it also cools the building substantially, and there's a good 7 or 8 degrees centigrade difference between the outside and the internal areas of the building, which are always in shade, and by having low roofs, you cut the sky off, so you cut the glare off in a hot climate, in a hot tropical climate. That's a very critical thing. We also engaged artists. This is an artist called Manjeet Bawa. We engaged them in doing elements for the building, so these are all the railings he did with these figures that he evolves. We used local granite, and the edges were trimmed and recycled for the waterfall, so you kind of kept a lot of the building material within the building, recycling even the waste that was sort of generated. And then, of course, there were many installations and art installations which used the metal technology that this company was very good at. And so the artists were sort of involved in these elements, but the most interesting was us developing a series of screens for ventilation, what they call jalis in India, which is a traditional element that filters the light but lets the air in, and we evolved a series of these screens using the scrap metal from the machine tool plant of the company. And so we went to the machine tool plant, and all the scrap that they were throwing we collected, and with an artist called Yogesh Rawal, we evolved a whole vocabulary of screens for the building that go from 4 feet by 4 feet to 30 feet by 30 feet and create a very kind of distinct visual vocabulary for the space. And of course, the density of these screens varies depending on the privacy needed, et cetera. But it was a contemporary kind of interpretation, and they're layered so that they can be removed and cleaned, and they also become large portals for the end conditions of the building. And of course, this is the architecture of impatient capital. This is not one of our projects, but this is the World Trade Center in Jaipur. Now, Jaipur is so hot that in the summer, you can actually fry an egg by just breaking it open on the sidewalk. And so you can imagine what this building will do for the environment there in terms of air conditioning and all of that. And this is what people are now building. So we were approached by Hewlett Packard, the software company from California, and they wanted us to add to their campus, which they had done. And these three buildings they had done, another architect had done, which were exactly these glass boxes that I was describing. And so in analyzing these buildings, we realized very clearly programmatically there was a set of programs that didn't need air conditioning, and there was a set of programs that needed air conditioning, which is where the computers were. And typically, what's interesting is all these software companies in India, they're glass boxes. So then the sun and the reflection is a big problem on the screens, and of course insulation is a problem. Then they invest in huge amounts in automated blinds that sort of can go back and forth. So it's kind of a ridiculous, and this comes from the fact that it's an image that's being sort of exported again, I guess. So we challenged that, and what we did was we strung all the non-air-conditioned spaces along a naturally ventilated street, and then we did these blocks as plugins with gardens and waterfalls and the food courts at the end. And so all of that was naturally ventilated. And so essentially, it was a very simple plan. And everything that you see in gray is not ventilated, is not air-conditioned, and this is air-conditioned, and a few conference rooms are air-conditioned. And what was interesting is that the business as usual is 200 square feet per ton of air-conditioning. If we use the lead kind of equivalent in India, we use the mechanical and chemical fixes, we would go to 290 square feet a ton of air-conditioning, which was considered, you know, for the gold certificate and all of that. We went up to 705 square feet per ton, but we did this by just not air-conditioning half the number of buildings. So, you know, it was just so simple, and it was, you know, so we said, forget the lead kind of thing, let's just not air condition. So none of this is air conditioned, but it also gives you better places for people to meet because they're strung together. It's nicer. This is in Bangalore. Bangalore is a naturally air conditioned city. People meet. They have rendezvous socially because they have a blog, and you know, I've been sort of following it because everyone here is really young. When I used to walk in there for my site visits in the cafeteria, I mean, just me going in there, I was 45 years old when I went there, but the average age would just jump because everyone was like in their very early 20s. And so they want to meet and be social, and I think a building like this allows them to do it. And so those are the conference rooms. Just the staircases we clad in copper, very thin copper. Copper is a ridiculously expensive material there, but we just sort of wanted to highlight the circulation because that became important when you had such a linear building. But it'll get patternized and it'll follow this. These are the conference rooms where you kind of feel you're surrounded by green. This is when you walk on below that spine, below the cantilevered conference rooms and things. So you have and then this is the street, which has got double height spaces, natural light, seats that are built in where people can sit and meet. And so the circulation, it's very light. It's really like a street which gets sort of transformed. And of course, it allows you to architecturally do more interesting things than if you were trapped in a glass box. The food courts become very interesting with niches where you have different scales for people to meet. It's all naturally ventilated and lit. And between the software blocks, which are also not glass, they just have strip windows at your eye level so you can enjoy the green. A pergola and the bamboo insulates it completely. So even the areas that are air-conditioned are actually highly efficient because they are very well insulated just by the way the building has been articulated. And so this last building, which is a corporate building, all these are global programs, just to, you know, to restate that, where we have attempted to challenge the business as usual paradigm to see how we might retrofit it in ways that are localized. You know, now it's not localized in the way of creating a caricature, but localized in ways to respond to climate, material, building craft, etc. So this is a building in Hyderabad. That's the building by Mario Botta. These are all glass boxes. Mario Botta has clad it in brick. And this was a site for an infrastructure company. This has now got much more filled in. I should have a more recent Google image. But this is a building for an infrastructure company who are building highways like from Delhi to Jaipur and, you know, all of that. And so we were sort of struck with what could be the right expression for this. And so this is the business as usual in that area. Now what's interesting is notice there are nets here. These are fishing nets. And what's interesting is Hyderabad, this politically, they're trying to split the state. So there are riots periodically. And all these glass buildings are perfect to be stoned. So now it's interesting that when you go to a vendor for glass-clad buildings, they have the details for the net built in. They sort of supply the nets with the glazing. So, you know, this is this desperation to keep this image and yet protect it. It's such a contradiction. It's actually unintelligent. And then some of these things have fancy panels to dim lights, and then they're called intelligent building. So it's ridiculous. So this is what we found was an intelligent building where it's a water cooler. And you see a kettle there. There's a guy who sits in there. And the guy serves you water, cold water, on a hot day. And all you do is you put your hand there and he serves you water. And he sprinkles this hut every few minutes so that it keeps it cool through evaporation. And it's, I think, a very, very simple principle. And this is just a small video. We studied in great detail, measured temperature and all of that. There he's coming to work. You see him coming to work in the morning. It's a free thing. The government subsidizes it. It costs the government nothing except the cost of transporting water. His kettle is out there, so he's open for business. People are drinking water, enjoying the cool water on the summer sort of day. People stop on their bikes. I mean, all sorts of people. And then he comes out occasionally. As you'll see now, and he'll, with that little mug, very little water in that little mug, he sprinkles it so that it, you know, through evaporation you get cooling. It's just thatch, which is local thatch, and it's really very interesting, very effective. And within the hut, there are modern earthen sort of pots, which again, through evaporative cooling, keep the water cool. So it's sort of double cooled. And he sits very comfortably in this sort of air-conditioned space and climate. He doesn't look like he's sweating. His push shirt is crisp. And people sort of love this sort of service. And so we use this, we said, how can we translate this into a corporate building? And of course, what's in fashion now very much is green buildings. And so, of course, we didn't want to stick a garden on a facade, which happens all the time, and that, you know, I don't know, it's maybe fine. Maybe plants will evolve genetically to grow like that. But we thought here, if we actually use the screen to cool, and we built in misting systems that would actually mist here. And so just with windows that are open, with hot air coming through this screen, would you be able to produce that effect? But also, would you be able to produce aesthetically the effect of changing gardens, a dynamic facade, depending on the species? So this building has just been finished, but I'll just share with you. So that's what the form that it took, with a large podium, with a garden on top of it, with the parking below, and then the trellis turning over the terrace to make beautiful reception areas. And then we studied the different species that would grow in the area, and then began to articulate the facades. And every facade is different depending on what it faces and what's been. And you could presumably replace the planting depending on new hybrid genetically altered flowers or whatever. But it's essentially a spec building, which is a concrete box, which is the easiest and most effective cheap thing to do. And then we created a trellis in cast aluminium, which we handmade in a small village near Hyderabad. So again, we challenged this idea that we, because it was going to be a metal trellis, that you would go to a vendor who would make something, but we said, how could we employ people to do this? So we went back to one of our old contractors, and he actually set up a whole unit to do this. And so this is a Photoshop rendering of what we imagined. It was essentially as if you didn't take the scaffolding off after the building was finished. But it was more than that, and we sort of set up, this little shed was set up to make the trellises for this sort of building. And it was all handmade, hand ground with a texture, so even without the plants in the sun, it would glisten. So that it, you know, had to also work in that contingent kind of situation. But it's also profiled in an interesting way to take the misting system and incorporate it all. And that's the finished sort of product of the frame without the plants. So it sort of has its own integrity with some conference rooms and key spaces that protrude out. And there's a catwalk in that space so gardeners can go up. The section has also been articulated in a way to allow courtyards that would ventilate, bring light in. So it's, even though it's a spec building in terms of the material of construction, it's been articulated more architecturally, architecturally in more interesting ways. And so these are some of those kind of courtyard spaces. That's the entrance foyer. We've sort of use simple materials like cement, but contrasted them with glass and granite, which is all very local. That's the upper level. That's the gymnasium, which has a clear window and a clear window there, and the cafeteria wraps around it. So it's a fun place to be because you have people eating and you have people running, and they look at each other in guilty ways. So it's sort of just had a little fun there. But that's now what's happening with the plants growing. Here you see this zone in the red flowers. That's a catwalk which has a hydroponic tray below it. So actually gardeners, they have 20 gardeners, can walk all around the building, all five floors, without having to get access in there. They can do it on their own terms, and that's the hydroponic tray. It has drip irrigation, so the misting system is really there to cool the building. And so from the conference areas, that's what you see. You see filtered light, and that's not a Photoshop image, that's a real image. You see filtered light and you know all of that. It'll get denser, you can decide how dense to have it, it's dynamic. So for me, this is the important moment in the building, going back to social thresholds, because this is a building which, unlike a glass box, which keeps and eliminates what might be ordinary gardeners who are quite poor, working in the garden, tending a garden at the entrance, they actually can make eye contact with even the CEO as he's sitting in a meeting. And sometimes they have a board meeting and you have a gardener who will walk past and smile at you. And I think this moment for me is the most important one. And that's the one had been imagining more than visualizing what the plants would be or how this building would be built. And trying to challenge ourselves to create this kind of porosity, this softening of thresholds, and in the process create paradigms where you don't have this kind of polarization that occurs. And I think dignity then is established in both directions, which is very, very important. And often these are all sliding doors. So I've actually seen executives suddenly slide a door and start talking to the gardener and say, look, trim it a little more, I want to see out, or let's make it more dense. And the only problem we had was once when a snake entered the building and they almost threatened to remove all the plants, but I had to calm them down. And so that's what it looks like. When you mist it, you can set the misting system to make it like rain or very fine, depending on the... Now, we are in the process. We've got a young scientist studying this building for the whole year, and then we're going to set up, because we're sort of experimenting. We couldn't predetermine everything in advance. So the systems are in place. Now we're going to, once we know how the temperature is varying and the humidity is varying, we're going to hopefully next year create settings for them for different seasons, which might be the most effective way to use the system. So, So this is just sort of a very quick clip to show you how, you know, this was all set up in this factory. The molds came in. This was cast. It just employed about 20 or 30 people. It was sort of aluminium, which is sort of, the texture has been sort of left on it. That's the one mold that had to be made. And it was a slow process, and the building started operation, and this thing kept coming on, and things got planted. So it wasn't like it had to even be finished. I mean, that was the trade-off. But because it was such an independent element for the client, it didn't pose a problem. So I think that sort of made a big difference. And there's something nice about the building taking that kind of time and people sort of occupying it and yet seeing the workers. And that's when the misting system at one setting is on. So you kind of can get a very light mix mist, or you can make it. And these panels are determined by the species that are growing based on those elevation studies we did. So the switches sort of are determined by those zones based on the plants. And it sort of is very refreshing, because in a hot climate like that, when you go there in the late afternoon and suddenly you have the whole building, the plants are all washed, and which is what the monsoon does in that image that I showed you, this sort of sense of rejuvenation and a kind of celebratory dimension. And of course, now different kinds of flowers are beginning to take shape, so we'll have to monitor this more closely. So just to go to the last three projects on local programs, this is a project for the Tata Institute of Social Sciences in a very remote site in Tulsapur. As you can see, you don't even see a tree. So we kind of developed a vocabulary using passive cooling, where we integrated the water tank so that you could have passive drip and cooling. This is the local vernacular. We kind of expanded on that to create a vocabulary of courtyards, very sort of frugal. Here we experimented with ferro cement, and we felt that in this kind of poor area, if we could introduce a new technology. I don't know how successful this is. The project had many problems, but that was the ambition, that we created this mold. We trained local people to create a modular system which they might be able to then flout for their own construction. And the reason for that was that not only is ferro cement very inexpensive, but you kind of do a lightweight fill on this to get a flat slab, which is then usable. In the process, you get a great amount of insulation in a hot climate like that. So there was a kind of twofold, and then there's a kind of rigor that gets established because it's a module, which means it's easy to then replicate. Then, of course, by adding other elements like this sort of pavilion on top of the housing, you get a terrace where people can sleep in the evening. But those are the kinds of spaces that you get. This project is about 10 or 12 years old, and it creates an interesting landscape, because in this very arid climate, this is like a ship that sort of sits there. And extending that idea of passive kind of cooling, this was a project in Goa using local laterite, where they wanted to create a think tank where 20 people could get together, meditate, do yoga, and also have discussions. And so this was a very low-cost project where we created a big roof using all local materials, and we created a series of boxes under the roof which you could go up to for meetings, for yoga, and those became the public spaces. So the investment on the roof was only one, instead of creating different pavilions. And so, because the rainfall here in the monsoon is very, very heavy, so the building would also then work for that climate. And it's sort of very sort of simple, and these become interesting spaces for activities like that. And a copper tube for the entrance, that's the only piece of sort of glistening material, but the rest are just sort of whitewashed walls, clay tiles, and the local laterite, which is a very beautiful stone that ages with time. It has a lot of iron oxide in it. It's quarried actually not even 3 kilometers from the site, and it darkens with time. This project is a project for Magic Bus, which John alluded to, and it's interesting that in a slum like this in Mumbai, which is deplorable conditions, you just the smile on that boy's face is moving. And so this NGO called Magic Bus has five buses that they paint red, and they're called Magic Buses, and they network with NGOs, and they take students to this campus, children to this campus, and they have weekend camps for recreation, but also for health, sanitation, and stuff like that. And so when we were approached to do this campus, the one constraint, we set ourselves two constraints. We said, this is an interesting opportunity to engage more widely in the city. So let's not fetishize architecture to go, because this was, you know, one of those projects, a very romantic street kids campus. So we said the two constraints we'd set ourselves is, one is we'd use the project to experiment in how we could evolve typologies that might be actually useful for the slums themselves. And so use the fees we're getting for this project and the time we're going to spend on it to run this as a research experiment. And the second thing we said is we would use materials only that are found in slums for these buildings. So masonry, blocks, sheets, masonry sheets, plastic, you know, stuff like that. And so this is the campus in its final. We did it like a series of pavilions that are strung along this very beautiful landscape. So the kids actually, it becomes a counterpoint to the otherwise that density that they live in the slums. And so that, and then it becomes an incremental project where you can add more pavilions as you go on. So on that landscape is just a series of pavilions for administration, which becomes a gateway building, the dormitories, a dining pavilion, and places for volunteers. So they have their little privacy, because volunteers come from all over the world. And so this was the palette that we established and where we could use it for different materials, for different components of the building, again, based on the idea of weathering, life cycle of materials, what could be changed in terms of maintenance, and expanded that idea. But we also evolved as a set of typologies where, for example, what's in red are wet services, so it could become, what is the administration building could also become a health clinic in a slum, or what is a dormitory could become a community center with a public toilet and a space for people to meet. And we, in Photoshop, we would keep looking at these typologies as we evolve them and photoshopping them into existing slums to see how they would sit and what they would mean. And again, it's just cement floors with whitewash and very, very simple materials. This is the dining pavilion, and you know, plastic can be attached in the monsoon there just to sort of protect it and to expand it. People sit on the ground and eat. The dormitories, which are modular based on the bunk bed sizes. And again, a very simple, very light construction frame with these materials to sort of clad it. And this is the gateway building that comes into the campus. And then, of course, the gateway building, this is galvanized metal. It's not stainless steel. And then that becomes a covered terrace where women can, you know, have adult education programs. And so it has multiple sort of uses, which also then help us imagine how it can be folded back into some of these settlements. And so, you know, expanding from that, we began to look at slums. We talked to Spark, which is an NGO that had just been commissioned by the government to create 300 public toilets in Mumbai. And they had World Bank funding, and the specs were concrete blocks. And no one actually used it. And what struck me was this image where I saw this child come out of one of these slums going to school. And I mean, just look at the whiteness of his socks and the smile on his face. And it's amazing that children like that can be intact. So we started looking at children, women, seeing what these toilets would mean. And the statistics are startling. The Human Development Report of the UN says in Mumbai there's one toilet for 1,440 people. The Spark, which is the NGO we are working with, placed it at 1:800, which was not much better. The Bombay Municipal Corporation said, no, it's 1:150. And they said our target is 1:50, which is deplorable because, I mean, imagine you could say 1:6, you'd say at least a large family, or 1:8, but 1:50 means you're not even going to give a family a toilet. So even the ambition is not very great. And so these are what the toilets look like. That's what happens to them. No one goes near them. The people start defecating on the outside the toilet rather than inside the toilet. And that's really what happens. So we came up with a kind of prototype using their specs where we said, we would stack the toilets. We would put the men and the women above with the children so they're safer when they once they climb that one flight of stairs. And what we did was we added on top of the toilet the caretaker's house, who's usually the lowest caste, but he gets the penthouse suddenly in the slum, which is dramatic in terms of his own pride, but also in terms of how he keeps the toilet. And to that, we attached a community space where children could go out to, could study at night and things, because otherwise they can't study in their rooms. There's often no electricity. And then, you know, that house I showed you with this monsoon image, which is very beautiful, that was for a guy who heads Merrill Lynch in Mumbai. And so I went to visit him, and I gave him this whole story. I made him so guilty at the end of the conversation that he gave me money to put solar panels. So we managed to get money from him to put solar panels, and we got it off the grid, which was very important, because what happens is these are given to contractors. The contractors, to save money, take the bulbs out or the bulbs get stolen. So at night, women and children can't use these places. But because it's off the grid, now they can, and children can actually study there. And then we used the experiments we were doing with that building to have a kind of green wall, which hasn't worked. So we designed 8 locations, and every time it went to the plinth level, the Bombay Municipal Corporation came and stopped the project. And this is a Photoshop image where we rendered it in, and we realized that all the places we were intervening in was places where there was space yet in the slums, and that's where we could get a site and intervene. And they became iconic buildings, in a sense, for the slum. And the Bombay Municipal Corporation was paranoid, because these were slums. They were expecting they were demolished. But the fact that you would establish a community center would legitimize it. And so everyone we did went up to the plinth, and it got demolished. And so we were not successful. So then we talked to Spark, and we found a really remote slum where we knew the municipal corporation guys wouldn't go. It was so remote because the roads were bad and all of that. And so we built one there as an experiment. And so these were many that we looked at, but all of these were stopped at that level, so they never happened. And so this one we managed to build in this remote slum. And it's built. We would do it differently if the project goes ahead, and we are working on ways of doing that. We would build it more lightly. Here we were using the specs that were available. We would not make it so prominent. Maybe that was part of the problem. But I think it sort of has changed partly the life of people there. This is children using it. That's the public housing the government did 5 years ago to move everyone from the slum in there, but of course no one has moved. So the point is that, you know, you could say this is a pessimistic view. I'm legitimizing the fact these slums will stay. But the truth is, this stay for a whole generation, and how can you make people's lives better? And I think that is a challenge, and that's why doing them more lightly so they're reversible might be a good strategy if one can pull that off. I mean, at least that's what one aspires to do. And this is just bamboo slats which sort of filter the light and the rain, but it becomes a lookout tower for these children who live in very dense situations with filth on the streets, but they can go up here, the air feels fresher, and they can play, study. I mean, groups of students can work. And these are the solar panels, which have now become iconic, and my client feels great about this. And so we entered this competition, which I think will be announced in a couple of days, which ARC Daily announced 3-4 months ago, for public toilets. So we designed these, and we won the first prize. And what we've done is taken the design much further, where we have even programmatically explored how it can be embedded in the community much more physically. You could also incorporate commerce on the base of these things instead of just giving the caretaker space. And then we are now exploring how in different areas, when you do these toilets in different parts of the country, how you can use the local craft and material to create different vocabularies premised on the idea that they have to ventilate well. You can't use glass. You can't use things that won't be well maintained. And then I'll just end with this project, which is a very low-cost housing project for, these are my clients, the two here, the elephant and the mahout. The mahout is the caretaker of the elephant. And what's very interesting about this project is it's a highly contested project in the way it originated. It's in Jaipur, outside Jaipur. The mahouts are all Muslims, and Rajasthan is a right-wing Hindu state, so they don't get that much patronage there. The fact that elephants are even there in Jaipur is an accident of history, because the Mughals bought them there for ceremony. When they ruled these parts of the country, they weren't there traditionally because they're tropical beings. And so this was a competition, and 4 or 5 architects, I forget how many, were invited. And on seeing the site that they gave us, which was a site that had been quarried by sand contractors, we realized that this wasn't an architectural project, it was a landscape project. And we felt that if we could transform this landscape, that would be the thing to do. And without naming my colleagues, I think the others all fetishized architecture. They studied the historic stables the Mughals built, and so these became big buildings. And I think strategically, I think that was a good move. And so this is where they live right now. They live in, this is what the government has built for them, so their elephants here and the caretakers live up there, which is a complete disaster because the mahout actually sings to the elephant when they have to put them to bed. It's a very close relationship, and the elephant basically lives lives with the family, as you'll see. And this was the site, and these are the contours. This was all excavated by the sand contractors, and there was one little hill. And this is what the elephants do. They take tourists up to Amber Palace, and they take them up to the fort. So by making it a landscape project and by using the geography that existed on the site, which was the excavated sand quarry, we began to reshape the site in ways to capture the water, which was actually... As a design idea and a competition, fantastic, we won it. But when we began to work with the government and the public works department, it's a complete disaster because in landscape works, they don't get kickbacks. So they were not interested in the landscape. So it became a challenge for us to sort of negotiate through this. And what they did was they built all the houses. So for 2 or 3 years, the project lay empty because there was no water and the government couldn't get water there. And that was to our benefit. Also, the government collapsed in that 2 years. And the two years when the project stayed empty with all the houses built because all the kickbacks had been settled, we managed to line the cavities, or one cavity, and create a small micro dam. And we didn't have the budget to line it because we were looking at, you know, rubber lining and all sorts of membranes to use. And then the local craftsmen there who had become very sympathetic to our frustrations and our efforts because, you know, the government had said, this is going to be six in your contract, it's going to be 6 site visits, and this is the lump sum fee. This project has to be done in 2 years. And by the third year, when we were trying to capture the water, we had already done 40 site visits at our own cost. So again, talking about cross subsidies, this became an advocacy project for us because it became a project of, you know, of social engagement in a sense, and other things cross-subsidized it. But what the local craftspeople told me there is they said, don't worry about it, this clay will harden in one monsoon. And they were completely right. We didn't have to do anything, and we managed to hold the water. And the 2 years that the government wasn't in power, or another government wasn't power but wasn't interested in patronizing this project because they wouldn't get the mileage for it, the place began to evolve in a sense. And then last year they began to say, okay, people can move in here, and I'll just sort of run you through the project. So this was the site as we acquired it. This was the scheme we made of the water bodies and put the clusters and the housing in areas. And that's the kind of landscape plan which essentially has the housing that you see in these clusters. And this was an existing building that had been abandoned, and now we are retrofitting it. This work is happening to create a school for the children of the Mahout and a little clinic for the elephants. And this is something we are proposing to the government. They haven't yet bought the idea of creating a visitor center, so when tourists come, they can climb this building and observe the elephants bathing and without actually penetrating the project. This is the designs for the house. So we actually decided to cluster it. So it's actually 200 square feet. But by adding courtyards and creating a terrace, you kind of double the usable house. So that's how we sort of expand the house, just by not doing what would have norm. And then we use Photoshop to try to convince the government what the landscape will do. But of course, it was totally unsuccessful. So instead of doing kind of a row house situation with a house, and which is what they sort of wanted because it makes the infrastructure very efficient, we began to articulate it such that you get courtyards and terraces. The elephant is attached to each of these houses. These are food stores in addition to what goes on top of the roof. And then you have a courtyard where these families can kind of have a sense of community and a collective sense, and a little terrace, a pavilion is possible. So their house really expands, so we've doubled it because this was what the brief asked for, but we added 22 and 20 by just adding the courtyard and the terrace pavilion. So through design, strategically, one can actually expand the house. And that's what a site visit looked like. These are the mock-ups you have to make here because elephants can't sleep on flat ground. And for different size elephants, you need different kinds of slopes and mounds. So we had to actually test with each elephant what was most comfortable for. So we had, of course, we had large, medium, small, and, you know, we did that. We did that lovely architectural classification. So it was an interesting process of a different kind of mock-up. But this is what happened after the first monsoon. The water stayed. It was yet a desert. The houses were all abandoned. But the elephants would come from where they were living, which was 10 kilometers away, to spend the afternoon bathing after they had worked on the ramparts. And they loved it. And you could see an incredible difference in just the health of these beings. And this is the before and after. So March 2007, that's what we had, and this is what we had in September 2010. And it's evolving, because now the government has seen the importance of this, so they've actually given us a budget to do planting and to line the other water bodies, which I'll show you in a second. So that became the plant. Now it's attracting birds, local species, and all sorts. It's a completely different environment. This bonding is very critical. When they bathe the elephants, this is where the bonding happens, because the elephant appreciates it in that kind of climate. And it's a really interesting moment. Now the clusters are beginning to get occupied. You can see that's the elephant. This is the courtyard. These are designed. You can see the food. We did this in light metal because of the budget, but the idea was they would store, because they store food for days. So once this dries up, they stack it on top. So you get insulation because the thatch is all on top of the roof. So it's designed, as you can see, with the beams to take that weight. But the insulation, but also segregates different families' food for the elephants without people fighting over it. And children can play in these courtyards because now they're safe and they're three families, so they're about six or eight kids always, and they sort of happen. And so it's really, he's part of the family. That's him coming home and being dismantled. There you can see the slight mound. Other people have, you know, started colonizing this differently, as in any housing project. And it was very minimal what we did here, because I'm hoping people will whitewash this in different colors. They're such incredible traditions. Once they feel a sense of ownership, which they're beginning to do, I'd love to go back here 5 years later and then document it, because it'll be different. Some people are actually growing grass because they see that as a sign of affluence. Because they have the water now, they can actually make a little lawn, which was an impossibility for them to do. And so it'll be interesting to monitor it. And you can see how the elephant is almost talking to that child through that little slit window that we've done where he can rest his trunk. And that goes up to the terrace where people will eventually build pavilions. We did one sample one just to demonstrate what it would mean. And of course, like I said, this ritual is important. We've now proposed this visitor center, which I hope they'll build. These are the budgets we've got now. We're creating the other water bodies. It's beautiful craftsmanship in Rajasthan, and just look at the way they create that pitching, and the way we've created the contours now in these water bodies is that they become natural ramps for the elephants to go into the water. So as the water recedes, they actually, it looks beautiful, but they can walk down into it very gently. In the first water body, we just cut the hole as quickly as we could, but the sand keeps sort of falling into. So now we'll stabilize all of these, but it'll be about five more years before this takes any form. And of course, these are just quite recent images where you start seeing now those new water bodies, the waters begin to fill in. You can see how it explodes, but you can see how beautifully that pitching is done, all by hand, all by local crafts, and that's the housing. So the whole area, the sense of the place, so to speak, has completely changed. And this is just a quick clip to give you a sense. And see, they have to walk to work on tarmac, which is in that heat, just completely mind-boggling. And they're beautiful animals. This is where they work. And this is the kind of architecture that most others react. The response for the competition was buildings like that as a way to resonate that, which was, I think, a completely wrong move, because unless you can make their lives comfortable, and this was just when the houses had been built, they didn't care. And we had just dug that water body and they had collected rain. That was in the first few months of the project. You can see how quickly they built all the houses because they were getting their kickbacks. And those were some of the demonstration pavilions we just did there so people would. And then after 2 years, you began to see the green, you began to, you know, just see a change. And of course, the landscape has changed. It's uncontrolled, it's not manicured. It'll evolve. This is a project where you actually, you don't fetishize about the architecture. You can't. You actually create an armature, you create an infrastructure based on which people can actually come. That's what true housing is about, where it's really facilitation. It's interesting how one learns from that, and that's Amber Palace in the background that you sort of saw. So, and this is just the last clip. You can see already how the landscape is so different. The trees are beginning to grow. It'll be completely different in 4 or 5 years. And I think the success will be when these things get colonized and painted and, all the rest of it. So I'm just going to summarize. I'm sorry, maybe this has taken a while. So, I think it's interesting to look at what practice in another condition can be in a situation like Mumbai, which has been, I think, the city that has nourished at least my thinking. This idea of the majority world, I think it's going to be an interesting challenge for everyone in this room, everyone everywhere in the globe, that I think a majority of, when we talk about global south, developing world, this is not relevant. The majority world is where they're going to need our services the most. And I think even for people training here in architecture, that's where the challenges for the future will ride. We are yet, all the paradigms that we are engaging with, whether it's in planning, conservation, architecture, they all come out of the industrializing West. And I think, can we, I think a challenge for us would be how we can articulate new positions, new conditions of urbanism, what might be the theory that might grow out of that in looking at architecture, building environments, engaging with society that come out of the majority world. You know, we've always denied or eradicated or tolerated or just improved these conditions. How do we anticipate these conditions? These will be the new challenges. So, of course, it means also looking more broadly through planning, through looking at infrastructure, orchestrating regions. The dimension of this is mind-boggling. If you look at the popular usage of informal city, just look at the scale of that and what does that mean. And I think architects, I think there's a space that architects can engage in that world, which we perhaps are not equipped to do, and one has stumbled upon quite accidentally just in the course of things that one has seen. And I think architecture being the sole instrument to order and to determine the built environment, cities, it's not going to be the only spectacle of the city. These are the cities of impatient capital. You can see it all drying up already. And so in this sort of shift of the majority world, I think how we think globally and act locally will become very important. How we shift the debate to these grand adjustments, even if it's temporarily, even if it means how we can strategize for 10 years, 15 years to make a generation, make a transition into a better world, I think will be the more ambitious and bigger challenges that we look at. And so as the world and South Asia and India, which is where my experiences have been located, become increasingly global, we have to be cautious about accepting that things are growing more alike because they begin to look more alike. Because when we engage with a deeper excavation of a site, of a place, of its people, of its culture, places that we operate in, and it's an understanding where we draw both from the objective and subjective reality of the place, I think the differences actually emerge more strikingly than before, where differences were actually assured when things look different. And so this is something we have to be really, really cautious about. And so thus, architects will have to obviously find a more rigorous way of defining this complex emerging cultural fabric globally. In India, it's even more difficult because we're set in a mutinous democracy. But we have to also see this cultural fabric as always ever evolving. So that's why these debates of identity and stuff are non-productive, because identity is something we construct, and therefore it evolves. Its significance in preservation debates, when we start talking about constructing significance, I think we really bring our dimensions and training to bear, because then we are being projective in our thinking. We're seeing new possibilities, new ways space can be arranged, rearranged, etc. And you know, Arjun Appudarai has said, for example, culture is a dialogue between aspirations and sedimented traditions. So in these interpretations that we as designers make of a place or culture, ideas of the future, as much as those of the past, necessarily have to be embedded and nurtured. And how we find visual expression for that, I think, is a wonderful challenge. And I think in the highly pluralistic environment of India, planning and design mechanisms and attitudes have to continually negotiate between these differences of architecture as the sole instrument of placemaking versus the temporality of the landscape, of habitation, new forms of celebration, also between the state and the market, the empowered and the poor, and how do we create new hybrid definitions or rubrics which allow us to be more effective within this understanding as designers rather than be trapped in the non-productivity of these sort of binary spaces. And I think really the question is how one can resist the remaking of cities in one image, which is, I think, what the cities of impatient capital have become. And I think that's what makes working in Mumbai and in India rather unique, if one can actually engage with this entire spectrum. Because I think once the architect really sees these various differences as being simultaneously valid, it'll open up a new space. And of course, then the challenge in that condition will be how we go beyond these polarized binaries. And I think that is the true space that we will be able to engage, I believe, with society more meaningfully. So thank you very much.
I think we have time for a few questions, if anyone has them.
Sorry, I took too long.
Julia. I have a curious question, because, of course, we're talking more and more about water as things are just scarce resources.
No, it is. It's a huge problem. And I mean, we have an incredible monsoon period, but we don't have ways of effectively retaining the water. And so it's a massive crisis. I mean, you know, the idea of water wars, which are going to sort of engage many parts of the world, in India it's going to be very acute. It's a huge, huge problem. I mean, I don't have the statistics on the top of my head, but it's a massive problem. And that's one reason why, for us, when we were doing this thing in Jaipur for elephants, for a low-cost housing, it just seemed such a no-brainer that unless you address that issue, what is the point of even? Because there was no way the government was going to get piped water for the Muslim community of Mahouds who earn 5,000 rupees a month. So it was just, you know, it's a huge problem. You know, maybe
so
one.
In that case, you were tapping existing rainfall.
Yeah, that's all we were doing was retaining it. That's it. I mean, that's. It's recycled. That is part of a large electronic park, so it gets water supply. But the hydroponics trays have drip irrigation, so it's very minimal. They're hydroponic, so they retain the humidity, and the misting is fine. It's fine, so you don't. It's not sort of wasteful water, but you only use it when you want to cool the water. So you could argue it trades off with the water that you'd otherwise use for air conditioning systems and things. The building is designed for air conditioning, but the idea is that if they can culturally, in terms of their lifestyle shifts, because air conditioning is also related to prestige. So I got an air conditioned office. So it's built in to do that. And, you know, the plastic pipes for the misters and the nozzles for the misters cost nothing. It's actually a very low cost solution. That is so unpredictable. So when you're just sort of, when opportunities for projects that need to be cross-subsidized emerge, you sometimes don't have a lucrative project happening. So then you go back to an old client and use the guilt trip to get the solar panel. So it's also about, I think, in terms of the ecology that I was talking about, that I think it's, you know, and this is when I say the binary becomes non-productive. So I have many colleagues who work with squatter rights, and they're architects, and they're trying to upgrade slums, doing wonderful work. But they get morally challenged to go to a rich man to ask for something. I feel one should be able to slide sideways. And I think the way one can do that is that when you're also working for the richer clients, that you engage with an aesthetic, with a set of design principles that are premised on local conditions, on local materials, and develop an aesthetic around that. I think that allows you to be consistent. So it's not like if you're going to work for a rich guy or you at Packard, you would give them the glass box that they wanted. If I was doing that, I wouldn't be able to slide sideways because I would be compromised in my own position. But the fact that one could demonstrate that even for HP, which is based out of California, luckily they had an Indian chap called Som Mittal who was in charge of it, who came to a lecture and I was talking about it, and he called me the next day. I didn't know him or anything, and he said, you know, I'm fed up of these glass boxes we're doing, and could we do something? And it just was a moment that, it was interesting. It was also the moment I had just heard from Michigan for my first teaching job, and I was leaving the following week to go to Michigan, and here the biggest project that had come to our office was like happening the same week. So I remember flying to Bangalore to meet him and saying that, you know, I'm sorry, but I'd love to do this, but I can't do this. He said, what do you mean? I said, I'm going to Michigan to teach. So he said, will you be available on the phone? Can you Skype? Can you do? I said, yes. He says, you know, I've never even met 90% of people I do business with in HP. We only do stuff. So I said, wow, they never thought of that. And so we took the project on. But it was just someone who was an enlightened client that was willing to accommodate much more than not only my presence not there with a small studio, but was sort of had the faith that we would reinvent this in some way. So when you do, when you work across the spectrum using the same principles, so to speak, I mean, this is all in retrospect. One was doing this all intuitively, and, you know, I mean, I must say this to the students, that these paths are never clear. You just follow your heart, and then at some point you can make sense of the patterns that you've left behind. And yeah, and so I think that's what allows this to happen. And so one is getting more conscious of it. I'm seeing many more opportunities now, which I couldn't have missed many opportunities. Now, every opportunity when I'm doing something for someone who has more money, I'm always asking for something that they would help cross-subsidize, if it's research or a book or things. In conservation, I mean, again, that would be a lecture in itself, but there's lots of experiences. I mean, in fact, that whole art district and things, that was all about advocacy and cross-subsidy from different people we had done different things from, including banks and stuff. So I think there it plays out itself in the urban context. And what is interesting, which is something maybe for more for the conservation students someday one would be happy to share, is there one played the role of a patron or a client. I was the client. I was sort of coordinating with younger designers to do street furniture and things. So it was a completely different role, which was interesting, where one subsumes one's designer's identity, in a sense, to get some of that done. So then you're strategizing and using your networks to get people to patronize some of these moves. So like the museum, I mean, that resulted in projects more for us because they wanted us to do it, but we actually showed them the possibilities. They weren't even thinking of those expansions.
Thank you for your work here. I'm from Bombay, so...
Oh. Oops, I wish I knew earlier.
Infrastructure. And your friends from U.S. were saying, no, don't do that. And somehow I see a relationship with what you do here. And the question I have is, have you been able to impact in the future of Bombay's transport and growth as the models that
Well, not the roads, no. So the quick answer is no. And so the longer answer is that I think it engages a different kind of dynamic. And I think what the gentleman refers to is when I take students from Harvard to do studios in Mumbai, I collaborate with local institutions and we do workshops which involve the whole city, 200-300 people. We get ex-municipal commissioners and planners, and we kind of have these debates. And so the idea there is to just sort of shift the discussion, because those are not projects that are given out. Those dynamics are completely different. And again, as Arjun Appudarai, my friend, describes it, he calls it the weapons of mass construction, which are sort of taking over these cities. And so the idea there was, for example, I think what you're referring to in particular is one of the groups from Harvard that comes with me from the GSD are the Loeb Fellows. Now they work with the Urban Planning Department and they participate in the studio as mentors. And they're often ex-planners and heads of different cities. So they come and share these mistakes and they show how in other cities they're pulling down these highways. So it will hopefully, it influences the discussion. And so what comes out of that, like that last year, one is the chief minister met us all, and he asked for advice on many things. So what finds its way into the political system, I don't know. But the fact is he actually invited our delegation and spent 2 hours with us, which is, by Bombay standards, as you would know, a big move. The other is a number of the planners, private planners, NGOs, activists, have now created networks with the Loeb Fellows and with others to get advice, you know, to write them, get them to write blogs. Aaron Napostak, who was there as one of the Loeb Fellows, is a blogger, so he's doing things there which young people are listening to. So it's very indirect. I don't know how it will permeate. I try to put these together as documents. We've been working on the Eastern Waterfront, which is 1,400 acres of Bombay Port Trust land, We made the first document. Someone will pick it up. I mean, I think what we are doing, my attitude to the bigger regional problems, which is what our studios are about and what my work with the Urban Design Research Institute in Mumbai is about, is what the World Bank used to say many years ago, is that create a shelf of ideas, because in these places the window opens for very little time, and when the window opens, you start doing your projects, you don't have the time, the window closes before you have your ideas. So my approach on the larger regional planning thing has been to create a shelf of ideas through studios, through research locally, through generating projects with students, and we document it all as documents and books and things like that. So that local NGOs, and that's why in that workshop you saw the Urban Design Research Institute, you saw a lot of local NGOs, because then they feel part of the process, which means they feel comfortable picking from the shelf of ideas. And I think the fact that you do it under an institutional umbrella, you don't have single authorship on it, which makes it makes the ideas flow much more. So somewhere down the line they must be being influenced, but not something one can make tangible.
We have time for one more.
Yeah, I think it's, ideas also travel from project to project, and so I think it's partly research, it's partly comes out of what one thinks is appropriate for that particular imagination of that design, and then go out and do research. So for example, that aluminium trellis that we did, which is the most recent one, it was really the scaffolding idea. We said we're going to have plants, what would be the cheapest way? And then, of course, the client was concerned about the fact, what happens if the plants don't grow? I want to, so we said then it has to have some integrity in itself, and we explored costs. Of course, we didn't want to use readily extruded sections and just go to a vendor and get some sort of standard thing. We thought we should involve crafts in terms of economy, in terms of employment. So we went back to one of the contractors who had done that machine tool building for us and done some of the metal work, and he was a young person, and he had been always talking about setting up his own fabrication thing. So we said, would this be an occasion? And he actually set up that tank. Is the biggest, it looks crude, it's in a little village, but it's the biggest anodizing tank in India because of trellis sizes in just that little village. And that happened because he was just someone so we keep in touch with. I don't believe in owning my own craftsmen. I have which is a longer discussion, I have a problem with that, only because we're working in different parts of the country. So what we're doing is we have a network of contractors and craftspeople, because for conservation work, there are very few people who work now with lime, for example. So, the people we try to keep in touch with. And I try to avoid wood, because again, I, in principle, find that problematic. We really have a massive deforestation problem. And even recycled wood we use very sparingly, even that's not really available. And so you can argue that wood is a very sustainable material. I don't know the metrics on this, but my intuition tells me it's sustainable once you've got to the point that they have a critical mass of forest that you can begin to replant and create that sort of closed loop, which hasn't happened yet. And the metals are, of course, by nature, less sustainable, but being used a lot. And so one was just trying to explore ways in that project how one could use it differently and make it more handmade, because the aluminum stuff is all otherwise extruded, never welded. It's always bolted. So here it's welded, and therefore it's hand ground, so it then allows other kinds of employment. We just basically wanted to make it feel handmade, which is a very satisfying thing in India. Stone is very easily quarried, and stones vary very much. So we've done research on that, and over 20 years of building, now have a sense of what is local where. But usually, it's always the local stone that we try to use, and then craftspeople emerge in that area for that, because these are all alive. That's the thing about India, is that craft is yet a continuous tradition. It hasn't been broken like in the West, which the world was devastated by devastating many millions in population, and you know, and industrialization making it uneconomical. But in India, it's much more continuous. And that's where conservation is easy. In India, the challenge for us in conservation is why would you not remake it? So, you know, there was a whole area of the Taj Mahal where we created a visitor center where there were these beautiful columns that were all destroyed. And of course, all my trained colleagues in preservation started flouting the canons and the different charters and, you know, wanting to leave things broken and stuff. But all the craftsmen I rounded up claimed they were descendants of the ones who originally made it, and they said, we can do this very easily. And they did. And, you know, we had Bernard Fielden was the chairperson of the committee, so we had everything go by him, and he completely blessed it. He said, there's no reason you shouldn't do this. So it wasn't like we had with the Getty Foundation, we had the World Monument Fund, and we had Bernard Fielden to chair it, and they all supported it completely, and we remade all those columns exactly like they were. And going back to the same quarries where the stone originally came, even the marble inlay I showed you was from Makrana, which is where the original marble for the Taj Mahal came. So, you know, that's sort of possible. In fact, one of the most beautiful sayings I came across in Agra when we were working on the Taj Mahal was the local craftsmen said to us, they said, there's a saying in Urdu, which is that the sign of an alive city is the sound of stone being chiseled. And, you know, that sort of is just so beautiful that it's a continuous process and things get made and remade and it's yet possible.
Thank you again.